Hello everyone. Random number generation is used in a variety of programs for a variety of reasons, from creating diverse video game worlds to keeping the internet secure. If you're like me, then maybe you've questioned how on earth computers can even generate random numbers. I mean, at a low level, computers are just performing a bunch of math operations, so how exactly can randomness arise out of this? What mathematical operation gives you a different number each time you do it? As I learned more about computer science over the past few years, I eventually found out that the answer to this is a lot more obvious than I thought. Despite this, random number generation is still a very interesting topic, as well as one of great importance to developers. So, let's learn how they work. It turns out that there are a plethora of ways to generate random numbers, but almost all of these methods can be grouped into one of two categories: pseudo-random number generators and true random number generators. Pseudo-random number generators are created solely using a series of math operations, which I'll elaborate on in the next section. This makes PRNGs very efficient, which is why they're typically used in situations where you need to generate a lot of random numbers, in video games, for example. They're also useful because they'll always give you the same output if you start with the same inputs. This is also their greatest weakness, though, as there are many times when you want an RNG to be unpredictable. In order to solve this, many people turn to the other category of random number generators. True random number generators work by measuring unpredictable processes that occur in the real world, such as atmospheric noise. Then, they define some function that turns the input into some kind of number. Because of all the factors at play, a good TRNG is pretty much impossible to predict. It's because of this that TRNGs are commonly used in web security, a scenario where you don't want people to be able to guess your next output. Tom Scott actually has a pretty cool video about people who use lava lamps as a source of RNG for this exact purpose. So, now you understand the difference between PRNGs and TRNGs. That being said, this series is mainly focused on video game programming, so I'll be spending the remainder of this video showing how PRNGs work. To make a pseudo-random number generator, we're going to need to define a function that gives a different output each time we run it. I might have made this sound difficult in the intro, but it's actually very simple to do by using recursion. A recursive function will perform some kind of operation on the previous output in order to get the next output. For example, what if we made a function that just added 1 to the previous value it returned? We would start with 1, and then it would give us 2, then 3, and so on. If we look at what happens for the first 50 iterations, we can see that this does return a different value each time it's run, but the values are way too predictable to be useful. One way to make this a little better is to introduce another operation into it. In our new function, we'll multiply the previous number by 2 and then add 3 to it. We'll start with 1 again, then we'll get 5, then 13, then 29, and so on. If we keep doing this, our number will get infinitely large, which isn't ideal because you usually want your number to fall within a specific range. To fix this, I'll use the modulus operator. If you haven't seen it before, it simply returns the remainder of division by whichever number you specify. When we generate a sequence of numbers after making this change, it looks pretty decent at first glance. However, there are still a number of problems, a few of which you might have already picked up on. To explain why this isn't a great random number generator, let's take a look at the properties a good PRNG should have. During this section, I'll be comparing the two random number generators we created before. For the sake of simplicity, I'll be referring to this as the addition one, and this as the multiplication one. Let's start off with what's arguably the most important property. A good random number generator should produce outputs that aren't predictable. That's like the whole point. The multiplication one is much better than the addition one, but it's still not great. Although the pattern isn't immediately obvious, you could probably figure it out if you looked at it for long enough. You can go ahead and try with this sequence if you want to. Another important property that the multiplication one is even worse at is uniform distribution. Basically, when you repeatedly run the random number generator, you want it to give you each number an approximately equal number of times. You may have noticed this problem already, but ours is only capable of returning odd numbers. It also has a slight bias towards smaller numbers, because once the numbers get larger, it'll usually just wrap around. A proper random number generator wouldn't have these problems, and would instead return every number with about the same probability. A third important property is that the random number generator should have a long period, which means it can generate a large amount of numbers before it eventually repeats itself. Because they're created with a computer, all PRNGs have a finite period. At some point, when the input parameters inevitably end up being the same as they were when the program started, it'll generate the exact same sequence of numbers again. The period in the multiplication one, like all of its other attributes, isn't that great. It only takes 20 iterations for it to loop back to 5, and then it just repeats from there. The final property is that the three previously mentioned properties are consistent regardless of what number we started with. For example, in the multiplication one, if we had started with a seed of 2 instead of a seed of 1, the period becomes much shorter than it was before. Usually, once the period falls apart, then the first two attributes do as well. With the proper random number generator, we would be able to start with any number we want to, and expect the previous three properties to remain about the same. Now that we know all of this, are we able to improve the random number generator we made before? We can actually improve it a decent bit by simply choosing different numbers. For example, C++'s minimal standard RAND generator uses the numbers 48,271, 0, and 2 to the 32nd minus 1. This is certainly better than what we had before, but there are still other more complicated random number generators that are even better. The Mersenne Twister algorithm, for example, is used in the standard library for many programming languages, and also in Microsoft Excel. I'm of course not going to go over how it works in this video, but you can check the description if you want to read more about it. Now that we've improved our PRNG, that might seem like it's all, but there's still one more thing that's worth mentioning. If we wanted to use our random number generator in an actual program, we would need some way of initializing it with a different seed every time it's run. Otherwise, we'd get the exact same sequence of outputs every time it's run, which is pretty useless. Under these circumstances, you'd always get the same Minecraft world, your boss would always attack using the same patterns, and your number guessing game would have the same answer every time. So, how do we get a different number every time the program is run? Keep in mind that we can't use the random number generator to do this, because then we're back to the same problem we had before. There are a number of ways to do this without the use of a random number generator, and the most common method is to use the system clock. That way, the random number generator is initialized with a different seed every time, and, at long last, it'll finally function as a proper random number generator. And that's it. Although I didn't make any example projects for this video, you can still feel free to try some of this out yourself. As mentioned earlier, there are also sources and further reading in the description if you're interested. But with that, let's cue the end screen.